thank God. I'ma shoot high rats in the ass. And I'ma shoot them full of holes right in the bottom of their body. When I came to Chi-Town in 1983, I was so wrapped up, I was in motion. Doing it well in the past, I came up in the welfare and under my thumb. Kicking me in the ass, it was powerful under my feet. Getting it down to a T, it was on the right track. Doing it well on the side of the ring, doing it well on the side of the ring, doing it well on the side of the ring, doing it well on the side of the ring. I kicked it well in the mold. I kicked it well in the hole. It was the best above the rest. I told you I thought about it twice. It was so right. I sworn it was on the right track. Doing it well on the side of the ring. Doing it well on the side of the ring. Doing it well on the side of the ring. Doing it well on the side of the ring. It was.
Who's the man? The answer is Wesley Willis, a 31-year-old artist, musician, with no formal art training, who suffers from, among other things, chronic schizophrenia.
You damn right.
The main purpose of this video is to document how a pure artistic vision prevails, even through the adversity of mental illness, poverty, and abuses of all types. He has succeeded and endured. Within the last couple of years, Wesley Willis has acquired a bit of notoriety through the sale of his drawings, appearances on ABC News, art shows, and numerous rock concerts.
250 times of doing this and it's still the same.
Downtown at the Merchandise Mart in a few different places, they'll feature him with other folk art exhibits. They'll have him like drawing live, you know?
Oh, really?
People call him up and he'll go down and do that.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Does he get paid for that?
Yeah, I think, last time he went, I think he got $100 or something. And he sold drawings and they treat, fed him and treated him. Yeah. He's like the star.
He'll stood at street corners, in subways, all in order to sell his drawings and to survive. He doesn't just live to draw, he draws to live. His specialty is perspective drawings. They are all drawn directly from memory of an actual place. His canvas is a piece of board. His paintbrush is a Bic pen.
What was the most you ever seen him draw?
I'd say he was capable of probably knocking out, finishing two a day. Two good ones a day. Definitely at least one a day. And that's with all the interruptions and the schmoozing that would go on by him. Yeah. Customer, yeah. Or his battles with voices, right? The license plates and truck numbers, he puts in a lot of his drawings are real numbers. He doesn't make them up.
Oh, really?
Those are real numbers, like the car numbers on tractor trailers. God, his train's going by. Those are real numbers that exist. Mm-hmm. Or you'll notice his bus ads on his bus drawings. They're exactly what was on the bus, you know?
His favorite subjects include the buildings of downtown, 35th and Dan Ryan, where he grew up, and his favorite are CTA buses. As of 1991, Wesley Willis has branched out into the recording of his own music to CD.
Who killed Officer Perkins? Who killed Officer Perkins? Who killed Officer Perkins? Stanley Davis shot Robert Perkins because he carried a gun. That was...
It's very ambitious recording schedule.
Yeah, yeah.
Considering most people are looking to record 13 or even write 13 songs in a
yeah,
year
yeah.
And actually record it. Wesley's brought in something like 120 songs this year.
What's that?
I think it's just a matter of how many tracks he can put down.
Yeah, total dedication. Yeah. It's just like
totally wants to do what he does.
If all the musicians that came in here had as much dedication as he did, then you know a lot of good music would probably be getting pumped out.
Wesley Willis also fronts his own rock and roll band, the Wesley Willis Fiasco, on Spiral Records.
Walk with me and find out.
Well, we've got four bands that are officially, I guess, on the Spiral label, and we've got a couple under development deals. It's a growing thing. My safe is starting to back up with material, starting to get up to some frequency, but it's a real organic thing. I basically am always open to new musical things going on. Wesley right now is real organic. I'm very anxious to start releasing full Wesley pieces. We want to do a full-length LP with the Fiasco, maybe throw a couple of solo songs on there. We're going to have to start recording that soon.
But to fully appreciate the man and where he's at now, it is necessary to understand where he came from.
You can read those eyes.
Wesley Willis was born May 31st, 1963, to Annie and Walter Willis at Michael Reese Hospital on Chicago's South Side. He lived at 3746 South Lake Park, along with six brothers and three sisters, until the age of six.
Some of them are school teachers, some work in cafeterias, one's in the Army. Yeah, like a career Army, one of the sisters, from what he says. And he's always consistent telling me about this. So.
Do they ever write him?
As far as I know, there's no contact.
When, because of numerous complaints from others who told of the extreme abuse which was occurring at the Willis household, the family was split up. Some went to foster homes, others, such as Wesley, were sent to live with family. So, in 1968, Wesley was sent to live with his uncle in Phoenix, Illinois. He lived here for 10 years until his uncle was charged and arrested for the sexual abuse of a child. In 1978, at the age of 15, Wesley was sent back to Chicago. He lived in the foster home of Miss Rosella Howard. During this time, he attended Harper High School. Wesley lived here for 2 years until 1980. In 1980, at the age of 18, and having nowhere to go, he decided to move back home with his mother. His father, the one who perpetrated the majority of the domestic violence, had since moved out a few years back. His new home was the projects at 3739 South Federal. This is where someone even more dangerous than Wesley's father would enter his life. His name was Roger Lee Carpenter, Annie Willis's boyfriend. And he had a sadistic side which ran deep in his hatred for Annie's kids even deeper.
With his dad, and by that time his mom was with the boyfriend, who was another abusive bastard, the worst.
Wesley was the youngest. So by now, all the other siblings had moved out except Wesley's older brother, Ricky. Roger Lee Carpenter, through force, beatings, intimidation, and fear, would make Wesley watch as he beat Wesley's mother to a pulp. Roger Lee's favorite hobby was to make Wesley and Ricky watch as he received head from Annie Willis. Wesley's only escape was his art. In 1986, Roger moved everyone to 5152 Bishop. The beatings weren't as frequent now, but they still happened. Wesley knew he had to get out soon, but he felt a responsibility for his mother and decided it best to stay. In 1988, at the age of 25, the family was evicted and moved to 4601 South Indiana. By now, Wesley had been drawing seriously for 10 years and had gotten good enough to sell some. By 1989, Wesley had saved $600 to move out. Roger Lee Carpenter found out about the money. And at night, while Wesley was asleep, with a gun in his hand, he forcibly took the money from Wesley.